considered really speaking unviable commercially, which is not worthy of release. Nobody would want to actually see those. People want entertainment, people want sort of popular song and dance, and yet all these people are actually living over two people whose loved ones are actually in coma, and they're uncertain whether they would come out or not. Very grim in terms of the subject, and yet the kind of treatment that the story, you have Sanyukta Chawla, who started with, she wrote in woman from a Muslim family, a conservative Muslim family, whose interest is to be a jasus, a detective. I mean, extremely unusual, feel very apprehensive about. It made its mark, it had a major star playing in that, and it connected with the popular audience. Kattu Alankrita, she made Lipstick Under My Burqa, which has been making waves to in virtually every festival that it goes to. And when I say making waves, I mean, what are your considerations?
So I think that I speak for myself, but perhaps I speak for a lot of other writers and directors. I think very often when we are just thinking of a story, sometimes you feel like, before you can even flesh it out, you feel like, oh no, this is India, and we can't make this film. But I feel, on the other hand, there's also that feeling that this is a story I want to tell, and I must tell it somehow, like in some way or the other. And I feel personally I've been very fortunate, because I actually found support for the films and I was able to make them. But even now I feel like I have one script which I feel I've not even shown to anybody, because I'm like, there is no way it will get passed. So I feel, I think we kind of keep oscillating between feeling like this is a story I want to tell, and let me just tell it. So for instance, with the Lipstick Under My Burqa, I think I really wasn't expecting that there would be any kind of opposition. I was just making a film about four ordinary women, you know, who are trying to secretly live out their small little dreams. And I never expected this kind of backlash. So I feel also what's strange is that you don't even know, like you, you know, where that backlash will come from and where you'll be stopped in your tracks. But I still feel that no matter what happens, it's very important for us as writers and directors to really, and as producers, to support that kind of cinema. But I mean, I feel it's very important for us to courageously continue, because otherwise I feel there's no hope.
That's true. But tell me also, I want us to revisit where your sense of confidence comes from. And you're taking up a theme like that, that there are these secret fantasies or secret dreams of four women, okay, living in different strata of society, and the film is essentially going to be about them. A theme sort of links all of them together. What gives you the confidence that actually people might want to watch this film? It's very unusual. I mean, if you told it to me as at a concept stage, I might have a question. I don't know. Would people really be interested in this? What gives you the confidence that they will be?
I don't know. Maybe I'm going to answer not in a very correct manner, but personally, I feel that I don't know, maybe other people are like, you know, they're more equipped to like figure out what the audience will really want. I feel the only way I can judge something is if I feel like there's some honesty in it and it's coming from some truth of my own life. And because I feel, especially because I'm more of an independent filmmaker, I feel that the only thing that I feel I have to fall back on is that it's an honest telling of the story, and there's some sort of truth that one is exploring. And I feel if that honesty is there, it is certain that people will connect. I really feel like that.
If I can answer that question,
please,
I think,
anyway, good for you. We're all very proud of you, Alankrita, truly. Okay, and you hang in there, and we're all with you here. Sanyukta, what is it that actually you believe, which are again, okay, from another point of view, are you tempted to self-censor?
Well,
are you going to after the Lipstick's experience?
No.
Whoa.
Because I feel if anything, when I started making Lipstick Under My Burqa, like I was saying, I was just making a film about four ordinary women and their small little secret dreams. After this CBFC decision to refuse certification, I think it's made one thing very clear to me, that now more than ever, I cannot like back track on my path. And I'm very determined to continue making the films that I believe in, no matter what it takes and however difficult it is, because I feel like this entire certification issue is far beyond them not certifying one film. I feel that it's really about them silencing particularly the voices of women. And I feel that at this point in time, if I lose courage and hope, it would really, like, it, I feel like it. I just can't do that. And so I'm very, very clear that no matter what happens, now more than ever, I'm determined to continue making stuff which I believe in. It doesn't have to be obviously that it's, I mean, it's just genuinely what I believe in. And I feel those are the kind of films I've made anyway. And I feel particularly because the CBFC has tried to clamp down upon me like that, I'm determined to ensure that their purpose in terms of trying to silence women's voices is not going to be served. I'm really clear about it, and I feel that this is 2017. If we don't speak up and if we don't take a stand now, we really are sort of giving in, and I think that's the death of creativity and of artists in this country. So I feel that now more than ever, it's very, very crucial for us to really continue on our path undeterred. And I don't care what happens. And I'm very, very clear that I will continue.
Wow. Very moving.
I feel that though one can just only point fingers at the CBFC and be like, I don't feel that they're the only villains in the game. I feel as part of the larger amorphous film industry, we all complicit in perpetuating a scenario where often there's the same kind of content that gets more prominence, certain kind of films that really do not get support from studios, and so much fear because everybody's like so concerned with commerce. And also I feel it's not just one thing, it's like a systemic thing, because I feel it's exhibitors, distributors, I mean, I feel at every level we need like this opening up of the mindset. It's not only the CBFC. So I feel that's of course like a major roadblock. But I feel like actually for us to have, as a country which promises freedom and gender equality, etc., I feel in the year 2017, we should be working towards a really healthy popular culture, which actually has space for all kinds of content. And honestly, I feel that it's not just about the CBFC changing. I feel the audiences need to be more open. Studios definitely need to be much more supportive of alternative content. Writers need to stop self-censoring. Everyone needs to have little more courage, little more patience. So I feel that if we really want our country to have a really thriving cinema, one that is actually like what Ruja said, where all kinds of voices are there, I think each one of us has to take responsibility. And I feel it's not just about blaming the government and the system, but I feel as artists, as filmmakers, as producers, we all have, you know, this popular culture is a reflection of all of us. And even as the audience, I feel we can keep complaining and saying, oh, we don't have enough great films or whatever. But then we have to choose, are we spending money on films that are perhaps more interesting? So I feel maybe like overall some sort of serious self-reflection is required in all parties concerned in terms of what is the culture that we are creating and what is the culture that we are really engaging in also. That's what I feel.
True. Anything else?
I think more books. Yes. That's all. We've all grown up reading.
Yeah. Yes. Can we? Yeah.
Right. Firasa.
I feel I'm only driven by the story that I want to tell. And I feel like we all, I think, spoke about this element of truth and honesty. I feel that when one is, I mean, that's my personal experience and opinion. But I feel that one, when one is sort of writing or directing a film with honesty, one's politics anyway colors the work. And I have never felt that I have to now make a film which is some sort of crusade. I guess the the subversion just comes in into the work because of who I am and what I believe in. And yeah, that's.
I think none of us can be apolitical anymore, right? Given the times we're living.
It's
so if you're writing a story.
Anymore. Why are you?
Talking about scared, I think I'm going to start with that. This is a scary combination. I've never seen something like this. Both of you national award winners for your work and for yours with this lovely, with John and Jane. I think it's a beautiful mix, and the work shows of how you guys have come together from two different streams of this cinema. And I think I'd love to know the genesis of this entire process of how you guys came up with the project and what the whole story is.
Good evening, everyone. It's been quite a long journey, actually. Washin, I only knew when we started doing some commercials together. So I saw him in a very glamorous, way of very stylized, very glamorous. But when we started chatting while making those commercials, I realized that there was a lot more to Washin. I saw his film, Miss Lovely, and I was very impressed with the way he kind of takes his shots and the kind of eye he has for the detailing and the art, the production design, everything that goes into it. And at that time I was offered this movie where these other producers had come to me and they said that you've got the rights to make the film on Arun Gawli and we'd like you to play Arun Gawli. And I was like, are you guys crazy? From what angle do I look like Arun Gawli? And but I said, okay, it's interesting. And I started reading about Arun Gawli. I didn't know much about him. And I found him quite fascinating as a character. But I hated the script. But I really hated the script that those guys had given me because it had nothing to do with his life. It was just, a commercial water boiler, kind of unrealistic film that they wanted to do. And I said, if you're making a biopic, then it has to be a good one. And nothing came out of it. And I discussed this with Ocean a long time ago. And then one day I just locked myself in a hotel room and I started writing down, I got quite obsessed with it, and I started writing down, a story, which I sent to Ocean just to get his feedback on it. And he loved it. And I'm glad he did, because he doesn't like things very easily. And he said, okay, we're going to sit together. Because if we make your film the way you've written it, we'll be doing it in two parts. So we've got to make one film. And then we sat down and started working on a structure. And all the producers who were with us started running away. And we were left with Ocean and a whole bunch of a team that we had hired, who we had committed to that we were going to make this film. And we also realized that those producers did not have the rights to make the film. And then we had to go and acquire those rights. And from that, I think our journey began, and I think through that we got to know each other and we decided what kind of film we really do want to make, and what kind of scale do we want to make this film at, and what kind of funding would be required to do it. And we do not want to compromise on just anything and everything by a studio telling you to put in an item number where it is not required, and stay as true the story that we want to tell, which was not to glamorize or de-glamorize, but to let the audience make an opinion about the character we're talking about.
Yeah, I think that's more or less the way things came about. It was quite accidental, and I think the accidentalness of it, maybe neither of us thought about it that much, beyond a point. And I think once we started working, we discovered that there was a chemistry, because I've come from a particularly anti-industry stance. Arjun comes from a very different space. But I think we had a lot of respect for each other's understanding of the subject matter. I think one of the things that I said to him off-run is that I don't want to make a typical film. And he said to me, I don't want to make a typical film. So I think we were already on the same page when we started the project. And I said, I don't want to do a hero kind of thing, and I don't want to make a Bollywood gangster movie. I want to get into the period. I want to get into the atmosphere. I want to do it in a way where it's never been done before, And it's a risk. It's a big film. you know, there are always typical ways of making a gangster movie. This one doesn't do any of that. I mean, I'm talking even internationally, the way you light a gangster, it's like a top light kind of shot. There's a certain way. I've avoided all top light in this film. There's no top light. You know, there's none of that classic Marlon Brando kind of lighting. So just the whole approach of the film is very different. And I have to say that I never expected him to come with me all the way, and he really did. So I think that's the best kind of collaboration there can be when you actually work. And I think one of the biggest things for me was the fact that he had already engaged the writing. He had already engaged the process of thinking about Gauli as a character before I came on. So when I came on, I already knew that this guy's in it. It's not like just an ego project. He was already committed to the idea of who this character is, how he sits, how he, and I that kind of commitment I didn't expect. And it's really rare. And for me, then when you see that, you want to work with somebody like that, I think.
That's great. I didn't know you wrote this. So, I mean, the teaser looks like there's a lot of research that's gone in every detail. But when you started researching, what were basically the avenues for you to research this character who's very much alive? I mean, it's the time of biopics, whether it's Dhoni or Nirja, but this is very different. And if I hear, this is not a biopic and not a gangster film, but it's something in between. It's a story. How did that process...
Yeah, so the research was a lot, and if I talk too much about it, most probably I'll end up in jail, so I shouldn't. But yeah, you have to go to where this world is, you know, you have to go and you have to find the people who belong to this world, and talk to them. That's what we did. And of course, you had to get the rights and the permissions from the family. You know, also making it clear to the family that this is not something which is just going to be a film to, which is going to, be a propaganda around the character, where you're just going to be showing him as this good guy or, doing a different kind of an image for him. It's not an image building exercise. We are excited because of the story, because of the life he led, and that's what we want to really explore. And it took a lot of time to convince the family to do that. And fortunately, they came on board. They totally understood. And when Arun Gauli came out on parole and we had the opportunity to meet him, he really said, no, I don't want to be shown as a hero. You know, I tell my story the way it is. Because this is the story of most of the people who come from our country, you know, who could go on whatever levels that they go to, you know, just to survive. And when you want to change and you want to bring about a change within yourself, do the systems really allow you to do that or not? And that's exactly what we wanted to capture through the film. And I think we did so by making it not a documentary. And of course, you would kind of fictionalize a few things here and there from a cinematic point of view of storytelling, but more or less it's based around true events, and that's what we kept it.
Perfect. I believe you've got for the first time some stills from behind the scenes to share with us. Would you like to? Yeah? Can we have the first one, please?
So he's taken me to locations like you cannot imagine, you know, and there we are doing all these scenes. So so the first still was, yes, from Dagdi Chowl. Can we go back to the first one, just for a second? The first one that you showed, the one before this. So, and this is basically the BRA gang, which is Babu, Rama, and Arun. And I don't know why they call, and that's why they call their gang BRA. I didn't think it. They realized it's spelled out to be Bra, but I think that's basically it. Those are the three guys who basically are best friends and make that gang.
Go to the next.
This is Maksud's den, and basically it's an Eid sequence where everybody is kind of called, and it's very interesting. While I was researching it, even people who come from this lifestyle of being what we call gangsters or the underworld, they have their own rules as well. And one of the rules is that everybody during festivals, okay, meets as friends and sees if there can be a compromise or if there can be kind of, you know, any kind of negotiation. And they meet absolutely like that. They look after each other, wish each other, and then they leave. And as soon as they leave, they are enemies again, sworn enemies. But and the second rule is that they don't attack anybody who is your kin, like your blood relation. You know, so they don't attack family members of gangsters. They'll attack everybody else, but they won't do that. So it's kind of a reference of all of that.
I mean, a lot of this stuff is actually far more researched than I would say like a standard film. The research is kind of insane on this project. I'll take you through some of it, even in terms of clothing. I mean, I grew up in this city, so I feel a lot of the films that have been made in Mumbai or Bombay have not been made by people who've grown up here. I've grown up in seeing these things, seeing these spaces, and I feel somewhat that I've always felt the detail missing. It always feels very generic, the gangsters, and actually they're not generic. If you come, you're a gangster that comes from Lal Bagh, you have a certain style. If you're a gangster, you come from Dongri, you have another style, and another way of speaking, and another way of hanging out, and the way you wear your glasses is different. And I think that's the kind of level of detailing we got into in this film, you know, so that when you're in that world, you're actually absorbed into the atmosphere of the time. It's not just like, achha, everyone's a gangster. Each guy has his own form, in a way. And you will kind of see that through the pictures. Go to the next one.
Next one, please.
So this is my love interest in the film, okay, who's playing Asha Gawli. Her name is Aishwarya Ramesh. She's a wonderful actor from down south, from Chennai. And she's done a fantastic, fantastic job in the film. Her growth and her thing. And actually, Asha Gawli herself is a very, very fascinating character. You know, she's gone through so much and has held the whole family together because, you know, he was never there. He was hardly ever there. He was hardly around. And so she plays a very, very pivotal part in this film. And
I think one thing which was interesting about Aishwarya casting her, very non-typical casting, of course, because again, I come, like I said, from a more independent space. We could have always cast a more glamorous, you know, more, you know, familiar face. But what I think, and that's the kind of thing that I think Arjun was really backing on this project, which I have to say was something which really gave me some kind of commitment as a director, because you basically say that let's go with someone who looks like Asha Gawli, not someone who looks completely different, who has no relationship. And what's for us a great sense of praise was the family themselves, the daughters themselves, and Asha Gawli herself saying, wow, she looks a lot like me. She looks almost exactly like me when I was younger. And all the salwars and all that stuff, all of those things have actually been taken out of Asha Gawli's own family albums. We just replicated the style. So, you know, there's a sense of authenticity with this.
He would get, I think we blew up some 18 washing machines, you know, because he wanted the clothes to age on a certain level. And then he says, but it doesn't look right, it doesn't look right. And he said, what have you been doing? I said, Oshim, take it easy. You know, you've blown up 18 washing machines. So he said, but why are they washing it in washing machines? At that time, there were no washing machines. You have to wash it with your hands. So the whole costume department had to go back and wash those clothes with their hands and get that kind of aging. And that's the level of detailing Oshim works on. And he will not shoot if the shirt isn't right. You know, so you'd be standing on set, he would just not shoot it. So till he gets it exactly the texture and everything that he needs. And I think that is painful when you're going through it, especially when you become a producer on the film. But but I think when you see it in the end and the end result, you know, you don't want to have it in any other way.
That shirt's a character in itself.
Yeah, those shirts are amazing. I want all those shirts. They've all been stitched actually from the time. None of these things are available, you know. And the girls we had on this were amazing. They were going to small towns and getting fabric that they don't print anymore so that they could make these clothes. So a lot of that. And I think one of the things, just coming back to the shirt thing, I've always had a big problem with when I watch a Bollywood movie, is that why is the star wearing the thing that looks like it was just made and all the extras look like they're sweating? You know, I always had a big problem with this. Like, if everyone's a gangster, everyone's in the same space. And that's something I told Arjun. I said that, you know, we have to be in the same space. Otherwise, you're always going to look like you're standing above all the other characters that are in the room. And that was a big problem. So I think that's something, you know, these are the kinds of things that we were really on in terms of the style of the film. So you're immersed in it. He becomes the character. You don't think, oh, it's Arjun throughout the film. You lose yourself in the film.
I want to make a point on that, Arjun. Exactly what he's talking about, usually the work that you do are made to stand apart. You're the star. You are sort of at the center. And here somehow, how was that process to sort of not just adopt the character, but become a part of the entire set?
You know, I try to do that with every film. I mean, you try to do it, you know. The level of, here you're playing a character who, you know, is alive, you know, and he, you have to kind of look like him, you know, there has to be a resemblance, you're playing somebody. So that becomes different. Otherwise, you're usually playing a character who's fictitious completely and you don't know. So you try to imbibe whatever those qualities are, and of course then that level of detailing is not really that much until unless that character is very, very well defined. You try to do it with every film, but as I said, not everybody goes through that level or that effort to make it happen. I think the first challenge for Daddy was, will I be able to look like Arun Gawli?
Yeah.
You know, and I think before we even committed to each other, we did a look test. And we put some prosthetics on and, you know, we kind of worked towards it. And when we saw it and we just shot it on an iPhone, we were like, wow, you know, this just like came alive. And that's what became really, really exciting. So that was the first level of encouragement you got. And then to live up to it, you know, by creating, by casting the rest of the film, by creating that world and being able to just blend in became the key. So we got these amazing makeup artists from Italy, okay, Sergio, Simone and Ariana, they all came down from Italy. They spent, I think, 4 months here with us, you know, working on it. You know, we had Jess Lee, who did the cinematography, who's a DOP from Canada, who came down, you know, and she was a girl who was shooting a gangster film, you know, and that was, yeah, so we can go ahead with those pictures. Yeah.
Yeah, just some more stuff of the period, of the time, Ramanayak, Arun Gawli.
So the film goes from the 60s and goes all the way till today. And so that's kind of the 70s.
Yeah, just some stuff, the kind of stuff that you can't shoot in a real chawl, basically. Things exploding and, you know, like fun stuff. You can't do. Yeah. Maruti, it's very difficult to get Maruti vans like that. I think we blew up the last
one. Shocking, time. You can't find a Maruti van when you need one, you know, to shoot.
Go forward, I think. This was actually a good example. I just wanted to show you the kind of locations we're shooting in. That's in Kamathipura. It's the back of a sweatshop, illegal sweatshop, actually run by real gangsters. So it was quite strange because we were shooting this gangster movie and then we had real gangsters landing up on set threatening us. So that was a whole other level that we had reached in production, I think. If you go to the next shot, actually, in the next image, you'll see, I think, no, sorry, it's not in the right order, but okay. Or you can go forward.
That's Nishikant Kamath, who's playing...
Go back.
Who's playing the investigating officer, Vijaykar, in the film, who has a bone to pick with Gawli. And whoever knows Gawli's stories knows that, you know, he didn't have a... He had this one guy who kept going after him.
And he's also aging through the film. So we had to keep track of everybody's ages, you know, like they were 30 years old, they're 60 years old, you're shooting out of sequence, you're shooting with prosthetics in the middle of Kamathipura, 12 hours in the heat. Not an easy film to make, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go to the next one.
This is when we came into the 80s.
Go back. So this is just again more images from the time, from the period, shooting again on real locations. You know, just getting a lot of the texture of the city into the film. Then there's a bunch of stuff that's behind the scenes. You can just go forward. This character plays Hilda, who's one of the girls that actually ends up, you know, in the story, ends up betraying Ramanayak. Oh, I didn't have to tell you that. I can't. Okay, sorry. But she does it in a very interesting way. Okay. Okay, this is some interesting stuff behind the scene in terms of just locations where we're shooting, all the docks, smuggling stuff in the rain. Quite crazy. You go forward. Okay, they're a bit in the wrong order, but I guess we could just...
So this is basically just the vibe of the film. You see the lighting, the difference, you know, in era and periods. And
Arjun, that was a great producer moment 30 seconds back.
You know, actually, I'm just looking at all these stills and I'm just thinking, how the hell am I going to work in another movie? You're really, I mean, I've really actually been spoiled, you know, because you kind of get to do what you want to do and do it in a really, really amazing manner, you know, where you really actually, Oshin being the purist that he is, and me having to don my, you know, producer hat at the same time, the actor, and at the same time think about the audience, who we are making the film for, because finally you don't make a film to just watch it on your own. And you want, you know, to connect with the audience. You want the people from Dagri Chowl to the people in Punjab to connect with this movie. And, you know, so to have that kind of clarity. And I think the combination worked really, really well. And when you see stuff like this, you're like, damn, will I ever get an opportunity to work on a film which has this kind of matter, which has this kind of styling, which has this kind, you know, layering, so many complex characters, such great storytelling that goes back and forth, you know, and Anna's got a thriller vibe to it. I mean, the film won't be more than 2 or 5 minutes long, you know, and to pack everything into that, you know, and at the same time make it extremely accessible to everybody was, I think, the biggest challenge. And I think we kind of have achieved that. That we'll only know once the film releases. But the process and to get this, like you just see these images, you know, you don't see these kind of images. Every image, and this is just normal stills being shot on while the filming's happening, you know. And while me, myself, watching it, I get surprised. So I'm sure it would be something unique for people to see.
Ashim, I'm not surprised at the authenticity. I mean, even in Miss Lovely, it's just something that, you know, sorry, but we expected and were thrilled to see it. But in terms of treatment, Miss Lovely was still an independent film, and it was made for, you know, it premiered at Cannes and went on to win however many festivals, awards, national awards. This is a big film. So how do you keep the authenticity of your writing and your characters and yet tell a film that is not just talking to the Dagri Chowl or the people who know of Arun Gawli, but internationally can actually understand where you're coming from?
I think that's, to me, like what's really an exciting thing about this film. It's really exciting for me. You know, I've always been kind of, in a way, cushioned by that international thing. I can always make films for a certain kind of international audience because I come from that space. For me, what was exciting here is, can I make a movie about a folk hero that, you know, people that live in Dagri Chowl or just the working class that think of Gawli as a folk hero, can they watch that? Can somebody at Cannes watch it? Can somebody, you know, like that would be truly amazing. That would be truly exciting. That it can cut across all those lines, that we're not dumbing it down. And at the same time, it's super accessible. And then if somebody wants to watch it who's more nuanced, they're watching all the layers, they're seeing the layers. Somebody else may not be seeing it. That, I think, and we both really wanted a film like that, that would stay true to the story and to the space and not just suddenly. And I think that's one of the issues, frankly, I'll be blunt, that I had with the first set of producers when we came on. I mean, the first thing I told Arjun is like, man, we can't do like an item number here suddenly in the middle of this. Like, it's just wrong. It's not correct for this film. And if I wanted to do that kind of stuff, I would have done it when I was 20 years old. I'd be already directing like 50 films like that. That was not the idea. The idea was it was true to this. And you have the real material. You have a guy who's willing to give you his story. That he's able to call himself Arun Gawli in the movie. Why would you try and make it generic, you know? So that's really where I was coming from with this.
Do we have more?
I think we got that combination right, you know. I think the whole, every time you go out there to make a film is you want to make a film, A, with a sensibility which you're not going to, when you watch the film, you know, cringe. Mm-hmm. A lot of films I've done where I cringe and I'm like, oh damn, why did I do that, you know. And now at least with the opportunities that you get in life, you can, you know, say, okay, do this, do less work, but do the right work and, you know, work with the right people. But at the same time, there's a responsibility. A film is not about, as I said, for a film which is to be indulgent and made only for me to watch and on, at home and say, look at this, how I worked on this, and harp about it. The film is, you're expecting an audience to come there, pay for a ticket, and, you know, walk out of there feeling something, you know, taking something back, and you have to give back. And so you have to be very, very clear about that. What happens mostly when we do international films or films for festivals, you know, they become very ambiguous, you know, they become very, you know, indulgent in many ways. This did not give us that luxury, because A, when you want to make a film like that, you could do it, but you have to shoot it in a room, you know. But when you make a film of this scale, you know, you have a responsibility, and a film which is true to an audience that is huge, that goes to which Arun Gawli has his own following who are going to come there, you have to be true to them. You have to be true to yourself. You have to be true to the budget, you know. And you got to kind of think about all those things, put them into perspective and say, are we being indulgent at this point in time? Then we should pull the reins, you know, and when we need to really go for it, do it. What's important in this whole combination was A, the vibe, the world, and I think that Oshim has created beautifully with the kind of people, the team, everybody who came on to the film. He was so responsible in bringing so many of those people onto the film who we worked with, you know. And my job was always to make sure that we are not disconnecting from the audience, you know, that if I can't understand it, or I don't know why you're taking this shot, don't do it, you know, because I don't know what's going to happen. And Oshim is very, very different in the way he takes his shots. This film doesn't have one OS. I've never, like, an over-shoulder shot of a close-up of another guy while talking. You know, I could be sitting here, talking here, and then the next shot's going out there. But then the way it's cut and it comes together, in fact, Deepa, who's our editor, first when she saw the footage, she's like, God, how am I going to cut this? And now it took her 2 months to just figure out what he was planning and how he was trying to tell the story. I could see it, but, you know, for her to also get into the groove of it and for it to be seamless, okay, it takes time. So when you're trying to do something new and different, but at the same time, making sure you're not alienating anybody was actually the combination that we wanted to get. And hopefully we've achieved that. That's what was the key.
I think achieving that combination as a director and with that vision, this subject was, like you said, a daunting task, but also a beautiful challenge that you've adapted to. But I want to know, as a producer of something like this, I mean, we hear day in and out that independent films are not, this is not independent, but it's not something with a big banner backing you and, you know, you have the whole plan. Did you have a plan on day one? Did you?
It's my banner. It will be a big banner. So.
It is Kundalini Pictures. It's a big banner. It's beautiful. But did you have a plan on day one of the life or the journey of this film?
You know, I said, I want to make this movie. Mm. I want to make it with Oshim. There's nobody else I'm going to make this film with. If he had said no, I wouldn't have made the film. Mm. And all the people, as I said earlier, in the beginning of our journey, had left us. There were a lot of people who had worked a lot, you know, a long time, and had stuck with us, and had not got paid. And there was a responsibility towards that. Of course, there was also a kind of an obsession about making the film myself. And so I said, okay, whatever it is, we'll start the movie. You know, we will do it. We'll see how it goes, okay? And we'll run with it. And I mean, I'm grateful to the whole team to have been that committed around it. So yes, it was done in a very independent manner because there was no studio backing. Okay, it was not an indie film because it doesn't have the scale of that, okay, but we are trying to shoot it in a thing. So I don't think anybody's really done that. You know, it was just your passion that drove this film, and I'm glad it did because it ended up being extremely enriching and is something which I think I've learned so much about production, you know, about how what goes into making a film if you really want to make it correctly. And I think created wonderful relationships. through the process of doing that, I know the kind of people I would definitely be using in my films going forward and how we would be going forward with that. And a lot of people who I will never work with, you know, at the same time, because it just they just cannot get it. They don't want, they're not passionate enough. So I would only work, what this film has taught me is to work with people who are only passionate. And then commercially what it does and what happens, that we will see when the film comes out.
I can't believe that, Oshim, you've made the next film.
We can move on. That's Lee being funny. We've got some stills in here which have been slipped in quietly. Just go back for a minute. And one more back. So this is a set we built, the Nagari Chol set. You can see it, you know, at night as well. So we spent a lot of time on the set. I was very particular about the kinds of light. You know, there was a certain type of sodium light at a certain point in Bombay growing up, and then it changed to tubes at a certain point. So a lot of the films also color-coded like that, so you know the eras without having to resort to cheap like sepia toning and all that kind of stuff. It actually is the way the light works in the film. So just go forward. Keep going. Yeah, it's just a night. Go forward. Okay. We can talk a little bit about Arjun.
No, we shouldn't talk about this one.
Yeah, some of this is actually from the film itself. Maybe we shouldn't talk about it yet. This too.
Yeah, so this image, like, I mean, this is a crazy image. And Oshim, I remember, told me, while we were sitting one day and we was working on the script together, that I have this image in my head about, you know, him having his child and a gun in the hand at the same time. And I said, Oshim, that's really filmy, yeah. You know what I mean? It can be like, you know, a gun and a gangster with a baby and all of that. But he said, no, you don't understand it. I have a different way of seeing it. And how this scene actually happens and what the mood of the scene is and where he's placed this, when you all watch the film, please, you will remember, okay, this conversation, it's so apt and it so beautifully comes in, you know, and it's so poignant. The story, the way it moves forward, but you have to watch the film. So these imageries are very, very strong. You don't see stuff like that, you know.
And I also like the idea, like what happens, right, when a gangster is, and no gangster, very few gangster movies deal with this. What happens when you're in the midst of a gang war and you have a child? Like, it's an amazingly dramatic thing. And no gangster movie deals with that. Like, just dealing with a family on an everyday basis is dramatic enough, right? So I'm saying, like, what happens when you're actually also fighting a battle and suddenly you have a child and you have to deal with the domestic and you have to deal with this outside world? It's something else entirely. It takes it to a different level, I think, you know. We can go forward. These are just some of the images from... is that it?
That's it, I think.
Okay, I think. Jump forward a bit. I think this repeats... Yeah, that's Jess. Talk about this a little bit. Actually, this is a film that had two DOPs on it. Jess shot most of it, but because we shot over three schedules, quite challenging actually for a director to have two DOPs, especially with such a strong style. I developed a lot of that style with Jess, who's a French-Canadian. It was also a very big film for her. She's come from a much more indie space. And Pankaj Kumar was the second, who just shot Rangoon and shot Ship of Theses, a lot of films. And he was the second DOP who worked on it. So that's also amazing because when you look at the film now, it's really seamless. You see some more. So I think there's some repeats here. Forward. Go on, go forward, please. That's Pankaj shooting now. Some of it is shot by him there. Go forward. Talk about this. Again, situation where you're shooting in real locations.
Locations are incredible. I didn't even know they existed. You know, they're like people living, and they haven't changed over years. You know, the people who are tailoring out there, you see a lot of Nike stuff come out of there, and a lot of Adidas coming out of there, okay? And all that's going on in the background. And there's a lot of embroidery, beautiful embroidery that goes towards to France and to all these places. And in fact, Rama was one of our one day we were shooting on this day, and there was this charpai, and they put the weave on it, and you know they kind of do the embroidery on that charpai. They've got the net and then they do the embroidery on it, and on that they put a chadar so it doesn't get spoiled. And Rama thought it's a bed, and he went and he sat on it and he went through this embroidery. This guy had spent, I think, 4 months, okay, doing embroidery on, and he went bang right through that thing. And I've never seen a guy look so distraught.
Yeah, but
the karigar who was there, I mean, he just held his head. He said, "Char mahine ke kaam ka, apne kya kar diya." And this is gangster paradise. So you don't even want to mess with these guys.
You don't want to rip anyone's embroidery in a place like that. No, you don't. And actually, we did end up having to deal with the repercussion of it quite badly at the end of the. But we will get into that some other time, I think.
I think this is all very exciting. It looks great. Next steps. I mean, we're waiting to see it. Do we have dates? Do we have a release?
So yeah, I mean, I think one is definitely to take it to Cannes, and that's where hopefully we will go first, and then after that, it's such a jumble of dates. There's so many films we made, so you guys kind of have to find the right date. But I think you will see the film in July. That's what looks very realistic right now. I think by mid-July we should be. We'll give you a date in about a week or two, but I think by mid-July we should be ready to come.
So are you planning, and of course, I mean, I'm not surprised if we're going to see this in Cannes, because, I think all of your films have, the last two, been there as well, right?
No, not only Miss Lovely, John and Jane was Berlin.
John and Jane was at Berlin?
Berlin, yeah.
Yeah. So do you ever feel that, once you're opening up the film over there or showcasing it there, there's a certain sort of slot that the film gets in when you come here to do a theatrical release, or is this also going to be the first time when you're going to...
Well, it's a film which we've been talking about. It's a film which I think is compatible to both, mm-hmm. And I think that is what we went out to make. So yes, we're not going to be apologetic about it and say, oh, this is a film that goes to Cannes, so it's going to this kind of a film, or be pseudo about it, but and at the same time, we're not going to be saying that this is a film which is a story of a guy who comes from grassroots of India. This is the story of that man. We're telling that man that story in the most truest way that we can. The teaser that which you've seen, okay, has got the kind of reaction which I think kind of puts the faith into us that what we went out to do was the right thing. When your driver comes up to you and says, "Dasuve," okay, and then you have, intellect who you think, from the industry or whatever, who will say, "Wow, I've never seen something like this in this genre. This is very, very unique." So you have both aspects of society kind of there, and that's what we want. We don't want to make any rules or boundaries for a film, and I don't think any film should have any rules or boundaries towards it.
We have about 10 minutes, so we're going to open up for questions. Can you please introduce yourself, sir?
I am Jyoti Venkatesh.
I know Jyoti, how are you?
When you decided to produce a film, did you make it a point to see Dagdi Chawl in Marathi, where Makarand Deshpande had played the same role? And number two, were you also a little bit scared about the political repercussions and the censor backlash that the film may get when it is shown to censor board?
Oh my God, now you made me think about all of these things. Initially, the first thing is that... you think that this is going to be a film which could run itself into a lot of controversies. And before we even started filming in it, we got into quite a bit of trouble, which we're still dealing with. It's not something that's going to go away. But I think we've got a tremendous amount of support. And I must say this, from our Mumbai police. Our Mumbai police really, really supported this movie. He did not say, oh, this is an Arun Gawli story and we won't let you shoot, especially when you're shooting on real locations, you know, where you're going into all of that, where a lot of that could be disrupted. So I think it was really amazing and it was very surprising how, and we're very grateful to them for the kind of liberty they gave us to make the film. What was your other question? Sorry?
Whether you saw Dagdi Chol, the original Marathi.
Yeah, so Dagdi I saw. I haven't seen the film, but I knew that they had made this movie, and Makran looked very much like him in the film as well. But the people who saw the film knew that it was not a biopic. It was a film that was a love story based inside of Dagdi Chol. So that was the difference. But what was encouraging from it was that film was made, I think, in a budget. A friend of mine produced it, Sachin Ayer, who, again, is actually Arun Gawli's nephew. And he made the film in, I think, 2.5 crores, and that film ended up doing 22 crores in the regional thing. So hopefully I get some of that audience back into the theaters. So that was a good kind of a barometer of the kind of popularity Arun Gawli has. And the third question was?
Censor repercussions and the censors. Political pressures. But you have the permission from the family, so there is no tension.
No, that's fine. We've got the rights. We've got, you know, it's all done on that level. We've got their blessings and their support. But from a censorship point of view, I don't know, man. They never cease to surprise you. So once we reach that level of getting the film censored, we'll figure out what's going
to
happen.
And a big compliment to Aushim and Arjun, the actor, because I couldn't believe that it is the same Arjun Rampal who is in front of us as Daddy.
Thank you. Thank you, Jyoti.
See, after what happened with Leela Bhansali on the sets, you know, and you guys are handling a very incendiary topic, and you had the guts to ask the family for the rights, and thankfully you got it. But my question is that, and this person is still alive, going back and forth between jail. Now, did you, or have you encountered, or did you think, you know, that you may, handling an issue where you could have probably just not taken those permissions from the family, because this gentleman is alive, and he's a gangster. He could say, nahi mujhe yehi depiction chahiye mera, nahi to tumhari picture nahi chalegi. So did you anticipate those kind of reactions and take some actions around it?
Yeah, so it wasn't easy to convince the family, because it is very sensitive. You know, you're going to go into his past, you're going to dig in there, you know, and you don't know, you know, he's scared legally what implications it can have on him. And therefore, we have to be, you know, very clear about how the film progresses. So you take incidents that is in public domain, you know, which people are aware about, of course, a little more from the family, from a research point of view, okay, which is how they, how he really is, you know, how people look at him. And one thing we mustn't forget is, why is this film called Daddy? Because that's the nickname that's been given to Arun Gawli by his people. He's not a bhai. He's not, a don or a thing. They call him Daddy. That means he has a heart somewhere which he has touched a lot of people's lives. And I think that's the human side of his story also, which was what we got from the family. The incidents that have happened, which is in public domain, okay, are in public domain, okay. The way we have, the structure of the film is in such a manner that it is from people's point of views. So it's not him saying, oh, I did this. You know, it's
hello.
About character's point of view. Yes, hello.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I'm Ramesh Rao from Film Bazaar magazine. Main usi area mein rehta tha, bhai ka naam hai. Main wahi bada hua hu. Ye 15-20 saal pehle ki story hai, correct sir, Oshan ji? To jab bhi kuch, kisko death ho jata, kisko shoot out hota, mere building ke samne se unko leke jaya jata tha. Jai Ram, Shri Ram bol ke. Hum log chote the, dekhte the, sab shoot out. तो क्या इनको मेरे क्लास में एक लड़का था वो बोलता था यार वो दगड़ी चाल में रहता था वो उनको वो सोने नहीं मिलता था इतना शूट आउट होता था वो सवेरे स्कूल आके बोलता था तो ऐसा कुछ सीन आपने किया है क्या जहाँ दगड़ी चाल में शूट आउट होते हैं और कोई वहाँ के जो लोग रहते हैं उनको भी लेके आपने कुछ किया ऐसा?
हाँ, उन लोगों के साथ, उन लोगों के साथ पहली बार तो आपको मिलना पड़ता है जो वहाँ पर रहे हैं, वो जो उस पीरियड के पार्ट थे, यू नो, जिनका वहाँ पर एक्सपीरियंस रहा है. तो उन लोगों से हमारी बातचीत हुई थी. उन्होंने कहा है कि कितना डेंजरस था वो पीरियड, यू नो, जब गैंग वॉर्स हुआ करते थे, और ये 90s, 80s, late 80s और mid 90s तक जो पीरियड था वो मुंबई, अ वेरी वेरी स्केरी पीरियड, यू नो, बिकॉज इट वॉज वेरी वेरी अंडरवर्ल्ड ड्रिवन. अभी काफ़ी सफाई हो गई है, यू नो, सब अभी बोलते कि अभी अब तो वाइट कॉलर बन गए भाई, यू नो, वो काम नहीं करते. तो आई थिंक एवरीबडी, मगर वैसे क्यों बने, वैसे वो उन्होंने क्यों किया, क्योंकि दिस थिंग इज वॉट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इज वट पीपल शुड अंडरस्टैंड इज कि द मिल्स जो थे ना वहाँ के, दगड़ी चौल वॉज मिल वर्कर के घर थे वहाँ पर. जब मिल स्ट्राइक पर गए, व्हेन द स्ट्राइक हैपेंड देयर, लॉट ऑफ पीपल गॉट अनएम्प्लॉयड, लॉट ऑफ पीपल डिडंट नो व्हाट टू डू, एंड द यूनियंस क्रिएटेड दैट, एंड दैट्स व्हाट क्रिएटेड द अंडरबेली ऑफ द अंडरवर्ल्ड इन मुंबई. तो अगर हम किसी को काम दें, किसी को, यू नो, उनकी रोजी रोटी आ रही है घर पे, तो वो बंदूक क्यों उठाएगा? वो बंदूक तभी उठाएगा जब ही हैज टू सर्वाइव फॉर हिमसेल्फ. तो आई थिंक विदाउट जस्टिफाइंग टू मच, और फिर एक होता है कि चस्का लग जाता है पावर का, जब आप पावरफुल हो जाते हो और सब आपकी सुनते हैं, तो वो भी एक नशा है. और उस तरीके से फिर किस तरीके से, यू नो, वो पढ़ते रहते हैं, पैसा का नशा आ जाता है जब आप, यू नो, पैसे कमाने लगते हो, और आसानी से आप बिल्डर को फ़ोन कर रहे हो, बोल रहे हो कि बॉस प्रोटेक्शन चाहिए तो उतने पैसे दे दे, यू नो. तो वो जो पीरियड है वो सब तो दिखाया, क्योंकि दैट्स ट्रू टू द पीरियड.
Hi, I'm Gitika. I teach TV production and TV entertainment in MIT University, Mumbai. So my question is, there are two types of audience. One is PVR ka crowd and another is Getty Galaxy ka crowd. So aapko kya lagta hai? Ye dono type ka crowd pull kar payenge aap?
Yeah, I think that's the idea. That's what I was saying earlier about the film, is that For us, I think the success would be if it can cut across different kinds of audiences. And I think, for me, the hope is quite ambitious that, like, maybe we can think of a different kind of Hindi film. Like, everything doesn't have to be either it's PVR or it's festival or it's, you know, like a big 500 crore film and that has a different aesthetic. Like, why do we think in such simple terms? Like, why can't there be more overlap like there is in other industries where we have something which looks beautiful and is still really big, or something that's very intense and it's still very commercial. I'm saying, why are we stuck to these old categories? I think it's time to start moving on and start creating, you know, more spaces for what Hindi film can do. That's my hope.
We have seen different films, like Once Upon a Time in Mumbai. So Kangana Ranaut was very glamorous, and your Asha Gawle is very simple and sober and decent, yeah, like Next Door Girl. Another D Company. So D Company was not commercially hit, but Once Upon a Time in Mumbai was commercially hit because of songs and looks, and so that's why I'm asking. So fine,
things have changed. Well, so, yes and no. You know, like, I mean, if you look at the arc of the industry right now, I think everybody in this room knows that there is no calculated guess.
Yes.
The things that we all know, all the glamorous stuff that's supposedly surefire hit, complete washout. Films that are really small, which you don't expect anyone to watch, they've done 10 times their business. I think the model is changing. I think we have to be...
No, and you see, I mean, I would also say that there are films like Rang De Basanti, okay, which kind of, I think, is a good example to give, where it went to two different kinds of audiences and both of them understood it. Why? Because it did not alienate people. हम लोग क्या करते हैं कि हम बोलते हैं कि अच्छा ठीक है, ये पिक्चर है, ये दिस इज द स्टार ऑफ द मूवी, दिस इज द हीरोइन ऑफ द फिल्म, दिस इज द बजट ऑफ द फिल्म, पुट सो मेनी सॉन्ग्स इनटू इट, यू नो, वी काइंड ऑफ पैकेज आवर फिल्म्स मोस्टली एंड से दिस मूवी, सो मेक इट पंजाब फ्रेंडली, मेक इट, यू नो, साउथ फ्रेंडली, मेक इट मुंबई फ्रेंडली, यू नो, यू काइंड ऑफ फेवर द सर्किट्स दैट गिव यू द मैक्सिमम अमाउंट ऑफ कमर्शियल सक्सेस एंड यू काइंड ऑफ पुट थिंग्स इन अकॉर्डिंगली. this film doesn't lend itself to that. This is a true story. You know, you have to be true to the character, but at the same time, we cannot make it really, really inaccessible. And we've tried to do that. Picture kya karti hai box office pe, how many people like it, kitne joote padenge, that you end up knowing only on that Friday that the film releases.
All right, Arjun, it's been 17 years. I wanted to say, you were amazing in Moksh, and that was your best performance till date. That is your best performance till date. I hope ke daddy ye jo opinion hai wo change kar paye. All the best. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think we're at the end of our time. Is there any last question, pressing question? Okay, last question for the gentleman in the front.
Give him a mic.
The kind of preparation you did for this role, I'm sure you did a lot of involvement in terms of method acting. You know, you try to internalize the character a lot. Were there any kind of psychological effects while playing the character, and you know, what you felt the most, and how did you overcome that?
I think you should ask my family that. But, you know, no, not really. I mean, I was very scared while playing him. And, you know, I used to keep asking Oshim, am I doing it right? You know, I hope I'm doing it right. It wasn't like, oh, this is the character and I'm walking onto the set like that. I think it kind of, as you keep getting into it and as you keep saying those lines and you start, you know, working with the people around you, it wasn't that, oh, this is the only way. Sometimes I would kind of go in a totally different direction and just feed off people. And I think the atmosphere that is created for an actor to go there, you know, sit, what he's wearing, you know, all of that, it just kind of brings that and helps you get into it. Because the minute they would say cut, there would be 10 people with checks behind my back to sign. So, you know, I mean, so, I mean, you went through all those different kind of things. But yes, somewhere I think what really helped was understanding him and understanding between us about not playing this guy as the typical hero, you know, not projecting him like that, going as close as we could. And then when we got to meet him, you know, just to see that body language and to see how, you know, he is, and he's, and what was really nice, and what I noticed was, they are very, very gentle, and they have tezi bahut hoti hai, you know, they are very polite, they are very humble, but they will say something, and you'll say, hold on, what does that mean? You know, so I mean, to get those little things into the script was very exciting for us. And psychologically, I think I'm quite okay right now. No, I don't know. I hope I don't
just
have,
about, just about.
Yeah, just about. I think on the edge.
Yeah.
Yeah, but a lot of people didn't mess with me. That was and a very another interesting thing had happened, which I'd like to share with everybody. I was one day dressed like him, and I was in Dagri Chol, as we were doing some shoot there. And his brother-in-law, okay, walked up and came and touched my feet because he thought I was him. And I thought that, for me, was like the biggest thing that could happen. You know, I mean, that was really, really incredible. So, yeah, it was really something special. Let's hope it's as special as we are making it out to be when you all see it.
I think it does look special. It is very special. And I think I personally feel it's going to do something that has never happened before. It's going to cross all these boundaries of mainstream, independent, festival. It's just, you know, going to be something that everyone can come and see, like you said, in different layers. And I want to thank you both for coming here, sharing with us this first look, the story behind Daddy, the magic of Daddy, and for putting yourselves through what seems like an artist's task, but I think it's going to be amazing. So all of you, ready for next steps. Thank you so much for coming here. Thank you, Arjun.
Thank you all. Thanks for coming, and really, it was really fun. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. We're beginning right away with a valedictory by one of the most respected and celebrated minds in the business of M&E. A big round of applause for Ashim and Arjun. Thank you, Ashim and Arjun. Thank you. That was lovely.